Open your Bibles with me once more to Deuteronomy 28:1 and go ahead and look up 1 John chapter 3. Oh, praise God. God has taken us to a new level in the Spirit in revelation of His Word. But now remember the Apostle James. James has a very unique place, and it's the reason we need to really carefully study what he wrote in the book of James, because James is a half-brother of Jesus and was raised in the house with him. Now, Jesus never did any miracles prior to his being baptized in the Holy Ghost in the River Jordan at age 30. The wedding feast at Cana was the first miracle performed, I really like what Brother Bill brought out to us this morning. The first work of God manifested was at the wedding feast of Cana, and he turned the water into wine. But the scripture says he perfectly pleased the Father, and you can't do that without faith. So he lived by faith for 30 years before he ever did that first miracle. You following what I'm saying here now? Now, James was raised in that household and watched him live by faith. Amen. Jesus brought the Word, the Torah. He brought the prophets. He brought all that into that household and directed that household, particularly after his stepfather, Joseph, left. I don't know where he went, but wherever it was, he went with God. But he wasn't there by the time Jesus entered into his personal ministry. Now, James said, if you don't become a doer of the work, if you don't act on the Word, then you will lose it, and you'll be like somebody that looks in the mirror, but you walk away and you forget what you look like. Well, you don't forget your general appearance, but you can look in the mirror every day of your life and not know in inches or centimeters how long your ears are. Why? Because you never took the time to measure them. You don't know how long your nose is from between your eyes down to the tip of your nose. Well, what do I want to know that for? I don't know. But you don't know unless, for some reason or other, you specifically measured it and acted on the knowledge of it, and it is parked by decision into your being. And that's what he was referring to. And then he called that mirror the Word, and he called it the perfect law of liberty. So when you make that decision to act on the Word and to keep the command of God, and like we heard this morning, all hell can't stop you once you make that decision. So a quality decision has to come, and then comes action. Now, let's read Deuteronomy 28:1 once again. And remember, we've been talking about the fact, and in the sessions that I've been responsible for, we've been talking about that the Word of God is commandment-oriented. Everything wraps around what God has commanded. And the reason He commanded it is because He knows more than we do. He knows more than the devil. And if you were in heaven, you wouldn't need to be commanded because there's no tempter in heaven, so there wouldn't be anything wrong there to be tempted with. Consequently, you wouldn't need a commandment because everything is going the way God created it in the first place. But here in this earth, there is a tempter here, there is a thief here, there is a serial killer in the spirit. He's not in the spirit world, but he is of the spirit world. So God gives us a command. If we keep the command, we don't have to understand everything there is to know about it in order to keep it. And when we keep it and do things his way, then the devil's shot down. I mean, he doesn't have any interest. He can't steal from you. He can't get his lies through to you because you're acting on a command. You do it this way, because this is the way that works. Amen. Now, the more you keep the command, the more you learn about it. Amen. God wasn't trying to keep Adam ignorant. He just didn't have, he hadn't had time to know and learn the difference between good and evil. He could have learned it without committing it. Jesus didn't commit it. Well, absolutely, Jesus understood the difference between good and evil, didn't he? How did he learn? It is written. It is written. All right. Let's go back and read this now. Deuteronomy 28:1. It shall come to pass, shout at least once. It shall come to pass. If you will hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee high above all nations of the earth, and all is healing a blessing. Is financial prosperity a blessing?
Yes.
Is having a strong marriage a blessing?
Yes.
All these blessings shall come on you and overtake you if you will hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Amen. Now, let's go over to 1 John chapter 3, and let's bring this over into the New Testament. Look at the 21st verse. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence towards God. Whatsoever we ask, we receive of him because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. Now, what things are pleasing in his sight? Well, love the Lord thy God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul and strength. That's the commandment. And love one another as he gave commandment. How did he give commandment? Love your neighbor as yourself, which is equal to the first commandment. Now, the thing that is pleasing in his sight is to love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor the way you are loved by God. Amen. Are you up with me now? All right. Whatsoever we ask. Doesn't that sound like Deuteronomy 28, 1 and 2? Huh? All these blessings will come on you and overtake you. Now, here, let me open up another thought to you here. We've already discussed it from Deuteronomy 28, that it is not that God has to get up off his throne and come down to heal you or to bless you or to do anything for you. But that's the religious concept we have of this. And it is so deeply embedded in the consciousness of Christian people. It has been so reinforced with every kind of a hokey idea you can think of. Even to the point of declaring that God doesn't do miracles anymore, so he has decided not to come down and help me. I mean, even on the negative side of it, we still had the same idea that somehow or another, I'm praying from earth and God's going to send the power down to earth and he's going to do this thing for me. And then, you know, I don't know whether he's going to go back or hang around a couple of days or what. And that is wrong. I don't have time to spend a whole lot of time on it, so I'm going to tell you right now, that is just a bunch of bull. Okay? I hope I made it plain. That's religious, man-made ideas. Now we're going to get into the reality of it. Praise God. He said, whatsoever we ask of him, we receive. Why? Because we're walking in his commandment. Now, what good does it do? What's involved when we read or hear some anointed person say, if you can believe, all things are possible unto you? What does believing have to do with it? If I'm going to have to believe, I'd like to know, you know, I mean, how? Why? What is it? Maybe I'm too inquisitive. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm ready, willing, and able. I'm not questioning whether or not I must believe, because I don't seen that in the Word. You don't ever question what the Word of God says. You believe it and then go. You can question why it said it, when it said it, where it said it, and who said it. But don't ever, for instance, Jesus was born of a virgin. I never question again that he was born of a virgin. I can ask how he was born of a virgin, where he was born of a virgin, who the virgin was, why he was born of a virgin, but I don't ever question again the fact that he was born of a virgin. Are you following me in this now? By his stripes ye were healed is not based on whether I hurt or not. It is not based on anything, but by his stripes ye were healed. Now I am healed. So now I want to find out how I got healed, when I got healed, where I got healed, and what I need to do to exercise that and bring it into fullness into my life and so forth. But I never question again, am I healed? Or ever confess with my mouth, Jesus is going to heal me someday. No, no. Now, when we begin to understand these principles and put them into motion, we begin to do and act on the kingdom of God that is within us. Our idea has been to pray and God send the power to bring the money. God send the power to bring the healing. God send the power to get this situation straightened out. God send the power. Jesus, I just don't understand. I mean, I've been praying, I've been believing, and I've been doing all this. How come it is? Now, you better watch it when you get started in that, because you're right on the verge of saying, I don't know why you hadn't done this for now. How come you don't heal me? You've been healing that bunch down there. How come you won't heal me? Very dangerous ground to be walking around on. You're accusing God of something he's not guilty of. And this is dangerous business. If it wasn't for the mercy of God, every one of us would have just been burned to a crisp. Just stand there and call God a liar. Well, the word says you have not because you ask not, but you ask and receive not because you ask amiss. Now, let's go back to our question. Why is it I have to believe? What does believing have to do with anything? All right, we're going to find out. You want to know?
Yes.
All right, we'll find out right now. Glory to God. I need a chair to put this on. I'm not going back up there. I don't like it up there. It's all right, but I'd rather be down here. Now, whatsoever we ask, we receive of Him because we keep His commandments and we do those things that are pleasing in His sight. This is His commandment, that we should believe on the name of His Son, Jesus the Anointed, and love one another as He gave commandment. And he that keepeth His commandment dwelleth in Him, and He in Him. Who underline that big time. Underline that. Hereby we know that He abides in us. He abides in us. I said He abides in us. Go to the fourth chapter. Chapter 4. Verse 13, hereby know we that we dwell in Him and He is in us. He is in us. He is in us. Say it. He is in us. Because He hath given of us His Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent His Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever shall confess, whosoever meaneth me, whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him. God dwelleth in him. God dwelleth in him. God dwelleth in him, and he in God, and we have known and believed the love that God has to us. Now, believing the love is where most Christians, most of them, I'm talking about nearly all of us, and at one time or another, 100% of us have failed in this, in believing the love. Believing that God loves me. Knowing that God loves me. And knowing that He loves me as much as He loves Jesus. Jesus said that. He said, Father, show them, 17th chapter of John, and let the world see that you love them as much as you do me. And He qualified that in the 20th verse of that 17th chapter before He prayed it. He said, I pray not only for these here, but also those that shall come by their word. Well, either directly or indirectly, everybody in this room came to Jesus from the word of those that were seated in His presence when He prayed that prayer. So He prayed this for 100% of us. That the world may know, He said, that thou hast loved me as you have loved them. I'll tell you, the first time I read that years and years ago and I stood up and said, God loves me as much as He does Jesus, my knees knocked together. Because of the religious fear that had been instilled in me. And I wasn't even faithful to church, and I got that much in me. Amen. I mean, I ran from church when I was a kid. I didn't like any part of it. Well, the church we went to, I would run from today. You understand? The only reason I'd go there is just because Mama did. I mean, and today Mama wouldn't go there. Amen. She didn't leave. They kicked her out. But anyway, you know, it's like that fella that was in another denomination. He said, you know, Copeland, I was an alcoholic and a known wife beater. in that church for 20 years. He said, I got baptized in the Holy Ghost and began with a big smile on my face telling everybody I'd been made the righteousness of God, and they kicked me out in 90 days. Quit beating his wife and they got rid of him. But he is glad of it. He said, I've never been as glad to get out of anything in my whole life. Now, let's read on here. Believe the love. Say it. I believe the love.
I believe the love.
I believe it's in me now.
I believe it's in me now.
I believe it is God.
I believe it's God.
I believe it never fails.
I believe it never fails.
We have known and believed the love that God has to us. Say it out loud. God is love. God is love. He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God and God in him. Now, folks, we haven't been but in two chapters of this little book. How many times is he going to have to tell us that he is dwelling in us now? The Apostle Paul put it like this. He said, the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Love never fails.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Never.
Amen.
Never, 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 never. Don't you ever, 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 ever utter out your mouth again. Well, I believe that and it didn't work. You better slap yourself in the face.
Yes.
Say, I ain't got no business talking like that. And correct it. And in a little bit, you'll see why we've fallen into those kind of traps. Why do we have to believe? Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we. In this world, not after you die and go to heaven, right now. There is no fear in love. Perfected love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. Now there's your red light on the dashboard. The first worried thought, the first yeah, but what if thought. I mean, you hear a verse of scripture, or you hear any thought coming through your mind saying, yeah, but it don't look like I'm going to get it this time. Boop, 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 boop. Forget all that. Get right back on your love scriptures. Get right back in there. But why is it so important for me to have faith? Faith is the connector to the anointing that removes the burdens and destroys the yokes. Now, go back to the 28th chapter of the book of Deuteronomy. We have to realize that the people that were being spoken to by Moses when he was telling them this were practicing these commandments. So what's wrong here? Why was that curse, why was the bitterness still functioning when all the time, I mean, they were out there in that wilderness, they couldn't go anywhere else. They had to go to the tabernacle. They had to go to the priest. I mean, they had it crammed down their throats every day of the world. I mean, and if you pulled away, boy, you was in big trouble, big time. If you're out doing something else. I mean, the earth, if you're still alive, you saw the earth split open and swallow up a bunch of folks. Oh, man, I'm going to tabernacle. I don't understand none of this stuff, but I ain't griping about it anymore. I can tell you that. Yeah, I'm going to keep this commandment without a... Whoa! So why was that death curse still functioning among them? You know what the word because means? That means this is why. Oh, yeah. I don't care if you're in the first grade or the 27th grade. Amen. That's what this means. Now, look here. Go over there. Are you in Deuteronomy 28? Verse 46, talking about these curses, all this stuff listed here. For instance, in the 61st verse, it said, and all sickness and all disease, which is not written in this book of the law, are under this curse. So all sickness, all disease, all poverty, everything the devil connected man with was there. And God is making his move to protect them from it. Now look, they shall be on you for a sign and a wonder and upon you and your seed forever, because you served not the Lord thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart for the abundance of all things. Can you see, can you begin to see at least why so many Christian people are just are sick like the world, broke like the world, divorcing like the world? Huh? And there's a lot of them think they're keeping the commandments. But a lot of them know good and well they're breaking them too. And can't figure out why they can't keep. Well, you know, I guess it's just my flesh problem. You know, the pastor told us last Sunday that no man can keep these commandments because it's strong through the flesh. And I know, oh, glory to God, when I die someday, I'm going to go to heaven and I'll be out of this fleshy body. I guess, I know. You know better than that, but you don't know why better than that. What's happening here? What's taking place? Well, you're trying to keep the commandments, but you're not praising God with joy and gladness of heart for the abundance of all things. And that will eventually lead you to believe there's not any abundance for you. You're still putting off to heaven what you could be walking in now. So you really need to be rejoicing in the name of Jesus. Oh God, thank you for the abundance of all things. Thank you for the cross of Jesus. Hallelujah. I learned a principle from Keith Moore years ago. And it has stood me in good stead all these years. When I blew a disc out in my lower back, and I'll tell you, let me tell you something. I've been shot. I've been stuck. I've been thrown off of horses, kicked by horses. I've been whooped more times than I like to admit. And winning a fight don't do you any good when you're already beat to a pulp. I mean, just because the other guy's hurting don't help any. You understand? I ain't never hurt like that in my life. I never had a pain like that. Have you ever had a really, really bad toothache? That's a nerve pain is the reason it's so bad. This is like having a toothache from the small of your back plumb down into your shoe. Oh, I was hurting. I was having a hard time getting my mind off that. I'm sitting out, hadn't slept night after night after night, and I'm out there on the back porch. I had a heating pad wrapped around my thigh and another one wrapped around the calf of my leg and had them tied on there. I went in the house and got some sashes off some old bathrobes, and I tied one of them up here and tied the other one down, turned the heat up on it just as hard as I could get it. And maybe if it'll just hurt worse, then that won't hurt so bad. And I'm sitting out there on the porch, I'd fall asleep for 15 minutes or so, and I'd wake back up. I'm sitting out there, oh God, and I ain't doing myself no good. Why? Well, the word of God come up in my spirit, and I heard something in Keith's voice, because I'd heard him preach it. He preached it into my spirit. And I heard Brother Moore say, you better be grateful for what you have instead of being tied up in what you don't have. So I said, okay. Oh, Jesus, I'm grateful. And I thought, yeah, dear God. I was tempted to say, yeah, but for what? Boy, don't be that stupid. Don't ever say that. For what? You ain't going to hell. That's one thing for what. So I said, Lord, I'm grateful for that tree. I'm grateful for that grass. I'm grateful for these flowers that Glory planted out here behind the house. I'm grateful for this chair I'm sitting in. And you know what? My other leg not hurting. Glory to God. Look at that. I got one good leg. Oh, I am so grateful for this good leg. Now, it didn't take about 5 minutes, and I got over into that, and I started being grateful. It stirred up my faith on the inside of me, and I started being grateful. I started naming off stuff I was grateful for, and I tell you, I just went on, and the list got longer and longer and longer, and I'm being grateful. I forgot all about my leg hurting me. You know what? You can't think of two things at once, and pain is a thought.
Hallelujah!
Oh, I can prove that pain is a thought. All they got to do is knock you out, and you don't have it anymore. Amen. Now, I really want to carry you on into this, and I'm having to be careful to keep this track because the Lord laid it out for me today. Let's go to Romans 8. Romans chapter 8. Why is it I need to release faith? What difference does it make? What is believing? Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Now, get this out of your vocabulary right now. Say, yes, Brother Copeland.
Yes, Brother.
Now you're committed. Well, brother, we're just a hoping and a praying. Well, you ain't getting anywhere either. Because hope without faith has no substance. Hope is in the realm of the dream world. I'm not talking about a dream at night. I'm talking about when you have this dream and it's not manifested yet. It has no substance to it. But oh, it's a dream of your life. And I've gotten a glimpse of what this ministry is supposed to be, and that's my dream. And I just dream, praise God, of the day, glory to God, when there'll never be another pain in my body forever.
Yes, amen.
And I dream of the day when I walk down there to that bank and walk in there to the president of that bank and lay that last car payment on his table and smile real big and say, I ain't coming back. Now see, that's the dream world. But when you first step off in there, it doesn't have any substance. There's nothing to bring it from that world into the material realm without faith. Well, Brother Copeland, I don't have a concept of how that works. Well, let me ask you something. I'll put this to you in a way where you do have concept. Can fear cause pain? Can fear make one sick? Can fear change your physical makeup? Can it change your face? Can it prematurely age you?
Yes.
Can it affect the color of your hair?
Yes.
Now, we're up in this part of the country. I met a lot of folks one time or another. How many of you have been to Niagara Falls? Let me see your hand. Now, Did you hear that story about, if you were there, I know you did, because that old barge is still hung up out there on right out over the falls. That looks like it's going to go over the falls, but the thing been sitting there for 50 years, I guess. But the guys that were in it when it hung up out there didn't know it was going to stay. It broke loose and they were all in this thing, and that water coming down over the falls there is doing 60 miles an hour. And man, it headed off the edge of those falls and they're seeing it coming. What? And wham, it just stopped. And nobody wanted to move. What are we going to do? Whoa! Well, they rigged a breeches buoy to go out there and rescue these people, and they got it tangled up, and it didn't work. Oh, God. And they wound up standing out there all night, man. Can you imagine? I don't want to breathe. All night long. When the sun came up the next morning, one of those men was totally gray-headed.
Wow. Gray hair.
Overnight, he was so frightened. Now, fear, as we know it, was originally Adam's faith. That's the reason it works on the same plane as faith. Faith cometh by hearing. Fear cometh by hearing. Faith is substance. Fear is substance. Read what Job said. He said, my fear has come to pass. It connected him to it. But now what I'm talking to you about is not just simply connecting to God or connecting to the things of God, but once it is released in your spirit, it is out there bringing substance from that dream world into this natural material world. We understand by faith God created. Well, we have to understand that by faith, but that's not primarily what that verse of Scripture was talking about in the book of Hebrews. It was saying we understand that God created all matter by releasing the spiritual force of faith. Now, oh, I see what I must do. Oh, God, I need more faith. You don't pray for something you already have.
Amen.
You already have healing. You already have joy. You already have gladness. Huh? If you're born again, you do. Because that was in the package. That was in the Spirit, in the Word seed that gave your spirit new birth. We've been born again, not by corruptible seed, but by incorruptible seed, the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. There are no spiritual birth defects. You got just as much faith as Jesus has. You have just as much hope as Jesus has. You have just as much righteousness as Jesus has, because He is the one, and the Word gave Him birth to His body and released His spirit into this earth. Are you listening to me now? We didn't get some half-baked born again. The problem has been in lack of knowledge, lack of wisdom, lack of understanding, and a gross lack of obedience to command. Now, Romans 8. Let's go to the 14th verse. For as many as are led by the Spirit of love. God is love, right? For as many as are led by the Spirit of love, they are the sons of love. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. No, you got out of the spirit of bondage, and you got out of being in bondage to fear. You have authority over it. Fear, until you were born again, your spirit, which had been disconnected from God, I tell you, I just rose up this morning when I heard Bill Winston say, you separate the plant from the ground, the plant dies. You separate the fish from the water, the fish dies. You separate the man from God, the man dies.
Amen.
Yes.
Boy, that said it, didn't it?
Yes, it did.
Well, Jesus came to reconnect. Now, here's what you need to see. Jesus separated from God and died. You can't half die. People think, well, he died physically, but, oh, Brother Copeland, he couldn't have died spiritually. Well, then he wasn't separated from God. And if that's the case, then his sacrifice wasn't a sacrifice, it was a murder. Because it didn't cover my spirit, and it didn't cover my soul.
That's right.
What things are spirit are spirit. Whatsoever things are flesh, Jesus said. So he had to cover the whole spectrum because the curse was in the whole spectrum. In order to be made a curse for us, he couldn't be made a curse physically and not be made a curse spiritually. Because it was in all the whole spectrum of human existence. So he had to take all of that. He was separated from God, but he was separated by faith, not by fear.
Amen.
He did it as an act of obedience and sacrifice. What Adam did is a pure act of treason. Amen. He became obedient to death, thereby defeating it totally and completely. We covered that. But now in his resurrection, he is resurrected spirit and soul and body. Amen. Isn't his body alive today? Does it still have the scars on it today? Yeah, Thomas put his finger in the holes in his hand. Well, he reconnected after he was dead. Glory to God. And became the Lord head of a new species of man. The reborn man. We are joint heirs with him. All right. When you connected with him by the word of God, your spirit was recreated in Christ Jesus. You are connected to the Father. You have everything Jesus has or ever will have. You are joint heir with him. He got raised with a glorified body, and yours is on the way.
Amen. Yes.
The only reason you didn't get that the moment you got born again is because Jesus needed you here to witness out of that flesh body. If you'd had that glorified body, you'd had to do the same thing he did. You'd had to live.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. We're in a good place now. Let's go back to the 15th verse of Romans 8. You have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry. Now, I'm still not hearing this. I've been preaching this in almost probably every meeting that I have preached since October following 9/11. 18th day of October, right after 9/11 in September, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me on a Friday night going on the way to the venue for the meeting in Hilton Chapel in the Washington, D.C. area. And he said, I want you to launch a war on fear. Amen. Amen. So we did that. Well, all of this then that you've been hearing, all of this is results of that. But one of the things he pointed out to me then, I'm hearing people agree. Every time I preach this, people receive it and get all excited about it, but I'm not hearing anybody cry it. I'm not hearing that unless we're in the meeting somewhere. I'm not hearing somebody just getting so excited about it in Walmart, they just can't stand it anymore. We have received the adoption. Oh, Lord. Whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself witnesses with our spirit that we are the children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with the Anointed One and with His anointing.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes,
that's right. Hallelujah. Amen. Crying, Abba, Father. How do you cry that? I began to cry it out. I began to shout it out. My God, I have a Father. Woo-hoo-hoo! I have a Father. He loves me as much as He does Jesus. He loves me with all of His heart, with all of His soul, with all of His mind and all of His strength, with all of His finances and all the wealth of heaven. Glory to God. My Daddy loves me, and He's rich, 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 rich. He is my Father. He has provided my healing. He has provided for me. Now, what's happening to me when I do that? I'm stirring up the gift of God that's on the inside of me. You can't stir it. I'm telling you, you can't stir it up by saying, oh, yes, oh, I have a Father, but I don't know why He don't do nothing for me. You'll stir up something else besides. Amen. Crying it out, my God. Oh, He loves me. You have to start doing that, Phil. Amen. And people get their hands off of you when you start doing that. Hallelujah. Amen. And tell the devil again, who do you think you are? Putting your hands on my body, the temple of the Holy Ghost. By the eternal almighty God, get your filthy hands off of me.
Glory to God. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm just mattering a blue hornet's nest. If all you ever saw was a wasp nest, you don't know nothing about them old big blue hornet nests. Them suckers will kill you. Mm-hmm. Just bust you good. Get madder than a hornet. It's the devil, sickness, disease, that curse. I'm not part of that. I live in the ambassador's house. My Lord, that ministered to me. Oh, yeah. I got green grass. I'll tell you something else I got. I got a fence around the yard made out of the blood of the Lamb, bless God. And you ain't coming in without a pass from inside. Amen. Hallelujah. There was a black entertainer some years ago, and he'd made a lot of money, and he bought a really nice home. That tickled me. And the folks around in that neighborhood, when he bought it, they didn't know who had bought this big fine house, and so they were curious about it, and he was working out in the yard. You see what's coming. This woman drove up there and stopped. She said, boy. And what tickled me, he said, uh-huh. She said, boy, what do they pay you for working in this yard? Because he really had a nice yard, and she's probably going to try to hire him to come over to her place. He said, they let me stay with the woman on the inside. You ain't coming in my yard. You ain't coming through that gate. Not without permission from the woman on the inside. And she the one that I stay with. You listen to me? We preach so much, man. I got so tired. Sometimes I just come home like this. I said, oh, God, don't let nothing happen. I ain't got no faith left. Oh, don't. Dear God. I remember Brother Hagin preaching one time, and they had their little dumpy house, and there didn't have any tables except made out of apple crates or peach crates or something. And they were using paint bucket lids for plates. And Sister Hagin came in and said, I want you to help me bleed from some curtains. He said, Aretha, bleed them curtains yourself. He said, I got everything hung on my faith that it'll stand. You hang them curtains on there and it'll fall to the floor. That's the way I want it. Come on, man. Oh, God. Oh, fought every devil in California for weeks and weeks. I'll be so tired. Oh, God. And sure enough, the devil would take that time, you know, trying to put something on you. And I didn't like it, and I'm grabbing, going, oh, God. Why? Come on, me. I just traveled till it just wore plumb out. Just doing everything you call me to do, you understand? Oh, God. Oh, God. I went to bed one night like, oh, God. And from right over here, the woman I stayed with, from right over here. In the name of Jesus, Satan, you shut your lying mouth. You take your hands off of this household. I mean, she lit into me, jumped in the middle of me, and cast the devil out of me, and knocked me out of the bed over into the floor. Laying there on the floor saying, oh, hallelujah, oh, glory. Now you understand why I said, devil, you ain't coming in here without permission from the woman that's on the inside. She ain't changed a bit. When I married Gloria, she'd go 2 or 3 days without ever saying anything. I really, until I learned what was in her eyes, I couldn't tell what she was thinking. And she said, well, I couldn't get a word in edgewise. Well, that's probably true to a degree. But them days are gone forever. I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost knocked that timid spirit in the head. She started preaching. I'll tell you one thing, she ain't got on me for preaching long since then. Mm-mm. Because when she started preaching, she said, I don't know what to do here. I'm just going to preach till something happens. Sometimes it's 3 hours for it to happen. But it happened. People start throwing crutches up in the air, you know something happened. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, I'm describing something here to you. I am describing what God has already set into motion. Now then, we cry out, my, I have a Father. Jesus is my blood brother. Amen. He's my blood brother. I'm covenanted into the most powerful family in the universe. Now, get this with me. Well, go to Ephesians chapter 3 once again. Religion's idea is that we pray, the power then is released from above, and if God doesn't release it, then it just ain't coming. So I guess I'll just have to figure out some other way of doing it. And then that gives birth and breeds this form of godliness, denying the power thereof from which we're supposed to turn into saying, well, you know, oh yeah, I believe Jesus is my healer, but what I better do here is get an appointment with the doctor in case he doesn't. I had a fellow come to me one time and he said, Brother Copeland, I'm so excited. I said, what you so excited about? He said, I am so excited. He said, there's a businessman that gave me a letter of credit. And he said, I just put it there in my drawer. And if I come up short any month, all I have to do is just take that letter out and just write the check for the balance. I said, is that right? Yeah, ain't that something? I said, well, I guess it is, but I've got a letter here that I've got in my drawer.
That's right.
That a wealthy Jew gave me called Philippians 4:19. I said, you keep that letter in your drawer. I don't want it in my drawer. I want this one in my drawer. And this one is guaranteed. That one is only as strong as that businessman that gave it to you. And I don't know, he may be broke next week. But the fella that's backing me ain't never going broke.
Amen.
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 He said, I knew you was going to say something like that. Amen. Now, we pray, you know, and God sends the power down just now. Oh, God, send the power just now. Send the power just now. Oh, Lord. No. The power came down on the day of Pentecost. And he never left. He's not going to leave. So what is believing? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but believe that those things which he says shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. In other words, that faith will move that mountain. But then the 25th verse of the 11th chapter of Mark says, and when you stand praying, forgive. Why? Because unforgiveness weakens faith and will bring it to a state of feebleness. Amen. Faith can fail. Love never fails. But faith worketh by love. Do you remember what Jesus said to Peter? Right as they were leading him away, leading Jesus away, he said, Peter, I pray that your faith fail not. It actually wasn't faith that was failing. He was failing the faith. But now anything that requires food without food becomes weaker and will fail in its intended role. Isn't that correct? God created you so that you need physical food. He created you so that you need mental nourishment. When you eat physical food, you produce a physical strength. And that's what it's called, physical strength. Amen? When you feed on the on intellectual food, it gives you mental strength, which is called will power. People that feed on mental candy all the time don't have any willpower. Can't even make decisions that mean anything. Well, I just don't know. You never know, I guess, what God's going to do. I don't know. You know, I guess. But I sure do like TV. It really bothers me when I see a young 10-year-old child with a video game stuck in his face. All he's learning is to guide his thumbs and his fingers. His brain's not expanding at all. Doesn't take any brain power to do that. And his gutless parents don't do anything about it. Well, I don't blame the kid when you don't feed him anything that's any better than that video game. That's the reason I'm so excited about what's happening in our Super Kids Academy, in our children's ministry. One of the young men on our staff was giving me a testimony of his young sons, which is between 5 and 6 years old, and his mother was teaching him in the car the other day to practice being still and being quiet. She said, "Now I want you to practice your quiet time right now for 1 minute. Just close your eyes and be very still for 1 minute. I'll tell you when your time is up." And so they did that, and while he was being quiet, he had a vision of heaven and went there, and he talked to, among others, David the king, and David told him he wrote the 118th Psalm after he had messed up, and God blessed him for it. That's better than a video game. You can't turn that child in another direction. Now, you know why he's like that? Because they started him that way before that child was ever born. They started it in her womb, teaching and training that baby the word of God and speaking the word of faith over that child. And he had a favorite song before he was ever born. They would play his favorite song and he'd just kick the daylights out of his mama. So she wouldn't let him hear it all that often. So what is believing? Faith is the spiritual force released out of you. Greater is he that is within you, not off somewhere else. Greater is he that is in you. The love of God is in you. The faith of God is in you. Righteousness is in you. All of the fruit of the Spirit is within you. The anointing you have received of him abideth in you now. It is in there now. It is in there now. Don't allow doubt, unbelief, any other form of fear or anxiety cripple those spiritual forces. That is you. The power for the healing of your body is in you, and it'll come out of you into your body. Hallelujah. All the money you will ever need forever is on the inside of you. That's what believing is. And when you begin to believe, you receive. And it's weak. And don't spend a lot of time crying and moaning and groaning. Go get a side somewhere. Get these tapes out and start listening to them over and over and over. "Well, Brother Copeland, I ain't got time to do that." Well, go on to the doctor. Did you get anything out of this today? Stand up and give the Lord a shout. And say it. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. The great one is in me. He is in me. He doesn't have to come from somewhere else. I receive it.
I receive it.
Now here's the prayer. The prayer is not, "Oh Jesus, come touch my body." No, no. No, no. The prayer is Ephesians 3, 14, 15, 16, and 17. He said, "Pray, Lord, grant me the strengthening of my inner man by the Holy Ghost. I am rooted and grounded in love. I believe I receive the wisdom of your depth, your breadth, your length, your height, and to have intimate relation with you, but I receive the strengthening of my inner man. I receive healing strength. I receive money strength. I receive anointing. I receive that strength. I receive that strength. There's not much use you stepping out there trying to do anything else until you settle that. Why? Because it's on the inside of it. That's what believing is. And there is a place in God where the weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but powerful through God. Powerful through God. And that power starts rising up on the inside of you, and Satan will take a hike because he can't handle that. Praise God. All right, be seated. Let's receive our afternoon offering.